The first major naval battle of the French Revolutionary War took place on the 1st of June 1794. This action had its roots in the failed harvest, an agricultural disaster that resulted in an impending famine across France. To combat this disaster, the new French Republic turned to her allies in America for help and arranged for essential grain supplies to be transported in a convoy across the Atlantic. By April 1794, the French had assembled this desperately needed convoy and was ready to begin the journey east. Across the Channel on the 2nd of May, the British Admiral Lord Howe sailed with his fleet from Spithead and, after escorting a British convoy of merchantmen out of the Channel, arrived off the French port of Brest on the 5th. The Royal Navy had received intelligence about the incoming French grain convoy and anticipated that French warships would leave Brest in order to escort the convoy safely home. With this information in mind, there were a number of options open to Lord Howe. He could attempt to engage the French as they left Brest, and then move on to try to intercept the grain convoy. He could leave the entrance to Brest open and then follow the French ships as they sailed to join the convoy, and that way be certain of engaging both. Or he could sail into the Atlantic and attempt to intercept the grain convoy before it had been joined by its military escort. This was the course of action that Lord Howe decided to follow. However, after 2 weeks of searching for the grain convoy, he had found nothing, and so returned to Brest, where he discovered that the French warships had left, presumably in order to meet up with the grain convoy. On the 19th of May, Howe once again headed out into the Atlantic, and on the morning of the 28th, whilst searching approximately 400 miles west of Ushant, he received signals to say the enemy ships had been sighted. The admiral in command of the French warships was Villaret de Joyeuse, a highly experienced French naval officer, who, despite his royalist connections, had managed to survive the terrors that were sweeping through France. However, it had been made clear to him by his superiors that the loss of this essential and desperately needed grain convoy would probably result in the loss of his head. As the primary French mission was the safe arrival of the grain convoy, Admiral de Joyeuse began a ploy to draw the British away from these essential supplies using his warships as bait. By mid-afternoon, the French and British fleets in a line-of-battle formation were drawing rapidly together, but at the same time both heading further and further away from the grain convoy, which continued towards the French coast. Lord Howe finally gave the signal for a general chase, and ranging shots began to ring out. The 25 British ships began their engagement with the 26 French. Despite the experience and expertise of the French admiral, the revolutionary years and the purge of royalist professionals had decimated the quality of the French fighting fleet, and they were no match for the British. Sporadic fighting and chasing continued through the stormy night. On the following morning, the 29th of May, Lord Howe recalled his ships into line of battle in order to renew the pursuit. The game that de Joyeuse had been playing to draw the British further and further away from the grain convoy had so far succeeded, but he was minded to ensure that the British continued their pursuit of his ships instead of deciding to withdraw and hunt for the convoy. After the sporadic fighting during the previous squally night, the renewed action became a more traditional battle between two lines of ships, a tactic which was notoriously inconclusive. With this in mind, Lord Howe gave the signal for his ships to turn and break the French line. This resulted in a general melee of individual ship actions, but again proved ultimately inconclusive, and as night fell, the two fleets drifted apart. After a night spent conducting essential repairs, both admirals woke on the 30th of May to find that thick fog completely engulfed their respective enemies. After the fog lifted briefly at about 10 a.m., de Joyeuse continued his game of cat and mouse with the British. However, as the two fleets once again drew closer, the fog returned, meaning that the action could not be renewed, a situation that remained for much of the next day. It was not until the afternoon of Saturday, the 31st of May, that there was any significant change in the weather. The two fleets spent the rest of the 31st reforming in preparation for the main battle, which was destined to begin on Sunday, the 1st of June. Intercept. The morning broke with a fresh wind, and Lord Howe signalled to his fleet his intention to pass through the enemy line in turn in order to produce a decisive battle. The sporadic actions of the previous days had successfully drawn the British away from the grain convoy, and now there was nothing left for Admiral de Joyeuse to do other than to meet his adversary in battle. As the British fleet bore down on the orderly French line, ranging shots began to ring out until eventually the two fleets collided and broadsides were exchanged. Despite the best of intentions, not all British ships were successful in breaking the French line, and so the action was ultimately not the decisive battle that Lord Howe had desired. After the battle, the two ragged fleets began to drift apart. For the loss of no British ships, the French had lost seven, six captured and one sunk. The mission of French Admiral VIA de Joyeuse to ensure the safety of the grain convoy, due to his bravery and cunning, had been an outstanding success. Lord Howe and his fleet had been drawn away from the greater prize. However, the statistics of seven French ships lost for no British losses was more than enough for the British public to claim Lord Howe's action as a brilliant victory, and as such, named it the Glorious 1st of June.